Hi everyone and welcome back to another live. So through these lives and chats we try to understand the journey of female athletes and women in the sporting industry to get an idea of their journey and maybe their hardships and what they've gone through and how they've overcome it. So today we're going to be in conversation with Snehal Pradhan. She's a former India cricketer who's now a cricket coach. She's a sports writer, a broadcaster, a YouTuber with a mad channel with 230,000 subscribers called Cricket with Snehal. She also has written over 350 sporting articles, and she recently co-authored a report called An Equal Hue, which talks about the growth of women's cricket in India and how we can progress from there. So let me just get her on, and then we can have a quick chat. Hi, Snehal.
Hi.
How are you
good
doing?
Good to be on. Thanks. I'm doing good. Is this Radha or Kavya?
I'm Radha.
Nice to meet you, Radha.
Nice to meet you. How is your day been so far?
So far, not so bad. Late start currently because of the IPL. So usually at night, staying up following the games. And then after that, just getting down to work slowly late. This is usually the time of day where things pick up.
Right. Of course, IPL is just around the corner. So anyways, today we're going to focus on a report that you co-authored. I recently went through it and it was very, very insightful. So I think everyone deserves to like understand more about it. So it's called An Equal Hue, The Way Forward for the Women in Blue. So can you tell us how you kind of got the idea of writing this and co-authoring this with a bunch of other people?
So the report is written by collaboratively with the three of us, Siddhant Patnaik, Karunya Keshav and myself. Siddhant and Karunya are co-authors of the book The Fire Burns Blue, which is a history of women's cricket in India. And Siddhant and I and Karunya were the only three Indian media to be in England for the 2017 World Cup, where India got to the final and got so close. And it was an amazing tournament, even though we didn't get the final result that we were looking for. But it was at that tournament where Siddhant, Karunya and I, being in the media, we were being flatmates together while we were traveling in England. And the three of us, we all were very invested in the growth of women's cricket. We wanted to see women's cricket just be the best it can be in India. About cricket a long time before it became cool. Similarly with me, I got, after my playing career, after representing India, playing for 15 years, got into media because I wanted more coverage, more exposure. But the report really came out of that pain of the loss of that final. And when we came back, we were really thinking what could have been done differently to get another result. And so Siddhant and I put down basically our thoughts about how women's cricket in India can be streamlined and how the best performance can be really got out of that. We submitted it to some of the people in the board, and then we met the people at the Sports Law and Policy Center who thought, you know, this is a fantastic idea. It should be done on a very large scale. And Siddhant and I took up the project. Unfortunately, he got ill in between. He passed away in 2019. So Karunya and I continued it. After that, I asked Karunya to come on board, and the two of us continued it. And a year later, we submitted this current version of the report to the Sports Law and Policy Center, who then published it. So that is, it was out of that pain of losing that final in 2017 that we thought, what can be done? There's so much potential. What can be done? So the first thing we thought before we decide how to improve is get an idea of where we are, and that's why the report basically analyzes the current situation and makes suggestions for how we can improve.
Right, and it very clearly has a bunch of parts and it tackles every issue separately. So just going on to the first issue, which is barriers of participation. I mean, many experts have said that there's not enough investment or no clear pathway for the women. But what do you think are the real challenges or something that can actually be properly changed so that there's more participation from the Indian population?
There are so many of these challenges. If you talk about physical barriers to participation, I remember playing on grounds where there was no changing room. So the boys, they would just change in the open, but since no girls had ever come to that ground before, nobody had thought to put in a changing room. There are social barriers that, you know, just abhi tak, that mentality where women's cricket is, or rather cricket is considered a sport for boys, or ladkiya cricket nahi khelti, is still a very prevalent mentality all across the country. There are financial barriers. There are examples within the ecosystem of Indian sport where some girls have been told ki, okay, after your studies, now you have to give up cricket because it's too expensive. And my own experience was that. I mean, after my studies, I was thinking, how long can I just keep taking money from my parents to play? I have to either get a real job, and that probably means I have to give up cricket. So whether for marriage or for a job, cricket is something that is expensive. So these barriers are very real. They exist, and how to overcome each of them is, I mean, you can write a research paper on each of those topics. So exactly. In a vast country like ours, with so much to do, there is a lot that needs to be done in terms of removing those barriers.
Right, and you mentioned that you were encouraged to get a real job. For a man, cricket would have just been a real job. So there's a big contrast that we have to kind of bridge that gap with. And I found one interesting quote in your report which said the BCCI is fortunate to have the biggest influencers in the cricketing world on their payroll, which is the men's cricketing team. So how do you think they kind of factor into this, and what maybe is their part in improving women's cricket in India?
I mean, if you look at the best sporting organizations, they put their men and women on the same level. If not talking about it financially at all right now, just in terms of the respect that both show each other and the support that both show each other. So we've seen individually members of the men's cricket team who have so much influence put up posts or put up tweets, etc., encouraging the women's team and vice versa. But what I would really love to see, and if I was a decision maker here, I would just say, I'm the BCCI. The men's team are basically on contract with me. Part of your contract is spending X number of days a year promoting women's cricket. Part of your contract is spending X amount of time or X amount of social media posts in a year, just helping the entire ecosystem grow, not just men's cricket. Just imagine a marketing campaign which is planned out well, which is conducted long term, starring Virat Kohli, starring MS Dhoni, saying that, you know, ladkiya bhi cricket khelti hai. Just imagine the power of that.
Yeah, it's really impactful. And men have such a big head start when it comes to cricket, at least in India, that, I mean, they owe it to the women to kind of pull them up to the same level. And obviously, our women have done so well despite all these barriers that it seems like a no-brainer to, you know, get them up and they'll perform much better. Like, so one more question I think I have is, you've already mentioned this, the painful loss in 2017 in the World Cup final. If we had made those 9 or 10 extra runs and actually won it, do you see when they came back to India, would there have been more of a sort of result for them? Would they have had more grants, more investment, more facilities, things like that?
It's an interesting question because everyone remembers that after that World Cup, which was in July, India did not play any cricket until January the next year, just because, you know, that was what the schedule was. So had they won the World Cup, would a schedule have been changed? But getting to that final and coming back and having that reception where they really won the country's hearts, I think it probably did 80% of the job that a win would have. In terms of just capturing the imagination of the Indian public. And then whether things would have been different, it's hard to say. It would have been a fairy tale and a fairy tale ending. I think it was definitely a fairy tale without a fairy tale ending until that point. But maybe the nature of that loss, so close yet so far, definitely contributed to the amount of popularity that increased for women's cricket. What I would say is that it would have changed the mindset of the cricketing community itself, that we are now world champions, rather than how the audience perceived them. It probably would have changed the mindset of the players themselves in that, believing that, yeah, they can do this. They can really build, they can really beat the best in the big matches, because that seems to have been an issue now in the last 3 years. We've made two finals lost those one semi-final, lost that. So whether India can reach the break that class barrier and win a trophy is currently where the sport is at. I think in 2017, if that barrier had been crossed, maybe would have been going forward.
Yeah, and you're right that it was a fairy tale. I mean, I was a 16-year-old watching that and I was just awestruck and completely inspired. I went to my school cricketing coach and I was like, is there a girls' academy somewhere? And he was like, no, I don't really know of one. Right.
Exactly. And I think, exactly.
Yeah.
That tournament inspired so many girls to take up the sport. I got feedback from my local academies that after 2017, so many more girls have been coming in. But the infrastructure to capture all that enthusiasm and all that participation wasn't there. So had it been there, or now we can we prepare it so that the next time we have that kind of a popular appeal, can we capture all the talent that comes in? That is something that I really would like to see.
Right. And you mentioned infrastructure in the report again, interestingly says that a lot of our talent comes from the villages and the towns, but a lot of our infrastructure is concentrated in the cities. So where, like, if we're not even able to harness our talent, how will we even build from there?
It's amazing. If you just look at some of the names in the Indian team, some of the biggest names, Harmanpreet Kaur, Moga, Smriti Mandhana, Sangli, Shefali Verma, Rohtak. These are places that before you knew these women cricketers, you didn't even hear about these places ever.
Yeah.
And the talent is coming out of there. You have Pooja Vasrakar from Shahdol, Poonam Yadav, Dipti Sharma from Agra. So despite not having a system, we are getting a team that is consistently reaching finals. Suppose if we had a system, I mean, we would be beating every other side in every other game. The current Australian team, which has won 21 ODIs in a row, 7 series back to back, why can't that be us? I mean, we are doing so much almost despite the system rather than because of it, especially at the grassroots level. The Indian team gets good support, the Indian team gets well taken care of, but at the grassroots level, discovery of talent, helping it get up to the Indian level, so much more to be done. India, with the huge amount of population of girls already playing cricket, huge amount of cricketing facilities already existing, and just how the game is already the number one sport in the country, should be world beaters right now, should be world beaters in 5 years, should be unbeatable for the next 10 years, just based on the numbers that we have.
Right, right. I mean, I completely agree. And I think one thing the BCCI has done now, they say they have done, is created this women's IPL where we have younger talent having an opportunity, where talent meets opportunity, as they say. But you know, just from an outsider's view, it seems like an afterthought where we are like, where is the women's IPL? And they're like, okay, here it is. It doesn't seem to be scaling up or growing, or, you know, they put it alongside the WPBL and we're just like, why would you do that? So what do you think, I mean, what does the BCCI need to do to just scale this up and give the women the eyeballs and the respect that they deserve?
So one thing would be, I would create within the BCCI, there needs to be a separate department that looks after women's cricket. It cannot be clubbed right now with junior cricket, boys cricket, other domestic cricket. And then when you have a separate department looking after that, then you have people actually giving interest into it as to, you know, what can we do to make this product? And I want them to look at it as a product. What can we do to make this product the best in the world? Something that people will pay to watch, something that we can sell for broadcast rights. And if you think in that way, there is a huge revenue earning potential from women's cricket. So what can be done for that is one question, having a separate administration looking after women's cricket, dedicated to women's cricket with the resources for that. Coming to an IPL, the fact that the BCCI before this COVID hit launched, before COVID hit, said that we would launch 4 teams this time in the IPL, in the women's IPL, still exhibition matches, but 4 teams. That means that they believe that there is enough talent for 4 teams. So what I would like to see the BCCI do is bankroll. You don't ask the franchises to spend money right now. You spend money, but let 4 team IPL start with the franchise branding. Let there be 4 willing franchises, I think should be easy to find. And let's have Smriti Mandhana playing for Mumbai Indians. Let's have Sunrisers Hyderabad with Mithali Raj. Let's have Kolkata Knight Riders with Jhulan Goswami. Let's have Kings 11 Punjab or Queens 11 Punjab with Shefali Verma from Haryana. Just talking about that gets me so excited. Think about the fans of Kings 11 Punjab, how they might feel having Shefali Verma in their side, having Harmanpreet Kaur in their side. So that is where I think the future of the IPL lies. COVID has pushed it back, I think. We've gone from 4 teams to 3 teams for an exhibition tournament. But I think 2021, it has to launch. And if it launches, it really can change the destiny of women's cricket.
Yeah, and we've seen the Indian women's cricket team play more T20s in the recent years than any other format. And we see that this actually gives them crucial practice with the best stars from around the world. That's why the WBBL is so successful and the Australian team does so well, is because they have this whole season to practice and to play with the best of the best. So, yeah, hopefully very, very soon, 2021, we see a well-launched IPL, and I'll be sure to be in the stands watching that. So, just... coming to the different forms of cricket, right? Everyone has said test cricket is the oldest form of cricket. It's the best, the purest form. But in the last decade, we've had 8 women's test matches. That seems really skewed. And can you tell us into why this is? And like 5 of them are played by the England-Australia test match. So obviously, a lot of countries are lacking in test cricket. So why do you think this is? And why do you think we still need to have women in test cricket?
One of the reasons is pure economical, that if you want to host a 4-day test, how many people are going to watch versus how much does it cost to really kind of host that kind of a thing. So obviously, if you have 4 T20s and you say we have 4 T20s versus a 4-day test, more people will watch the 4 T20s. So therefore, tests go down on the pecking order. Some countries have taken an official stance, like New Zealand, saying that we will not play tests, we will focus on the limited overs formats as a way to grow the game. And that's fair enough. I can understand when you have limited resources, you have to pick your battles. But the BCCI, having the luxury of being a board which has plenty of resources, I think should push test cricket for women because it is a format where India are likely to be good. India have done well in the T20 format, have done well in the ODI format, but we have a lot of classical players who can do really well in the test format. So just imagine, I mean, giving Mithali Raj that kind of time, and her batting is all about taking time. Her batting is all about, you know, she can spend the entire day at the crease. I think the Indian team will be very good at tests, which is why India must play more tests. I think it's the format that suits our style of play. And the last couple of tests that the BCCI, there was a phase where the BCCI showed interest, and there were 2 test matches in 2014. India won both those test matches, which again, that creates a good news story. So you make an investment in a format where India are likely to do well. Then if they do well, that creates a good news, a feel-good story around it, and then promotes more and more people to come into the shorter formats. I think that's a reason test cricket should be there. And probably most important is that the players value test cricket above other formats. I think they really feel that it is the format which brings the best out of you as a cricketer. And if we can get to play that and get to say, you know, we beat England in a test match, is probably more valuable than saying we beat England in an ODI.
Yeah, and I mean, the men's players have said it over and over again, is that the test tests you mentally and physically, and that's really the true test of a player. And why not have your women up there too? Like, so Snehal, I really want to ask you, this is one question that really bothers me, and I keep trying to justify it, is why does a federation that's sole vision should be, you know, promoting cricket in India, why do they have investments and money at the top of their head? Like, why not invest and then a revenue will come? Why say there's no revenue, so I'm not going to invest? Shouldn't cricket be top priority?
I think it's to give credit where credit is due. The investment in women's cricket has gone up in the last 5 years, especially in the Indian cricket team. For example, your top 20 odd players are taken care of with central contracts. That's something which has just come in the last 5 years. The kind of facilities they're getting, the kind of camps they're getting, coaching that they're getting is all being done well. And there's a lot of investment going into that. I mean, just even conducting a camp or 30-day camp probably costs in the range of 50 to 75 lakhs. So there is a huge amount of investment going into the top team, into the Indian women's cricket team. What I would now hope that BCCI also can do is increase the investment in domestic cricket, increase the investment in what kind of salaries domestic players get, increase almost a tiered financial structure. Like, for example, if everyone playing domestic cricket right now gets around 12,500 rupees, maybe keep that the same. But if you have a challenger trophy, highly incentivize that. Women's IPL, of course, will be highly incentivized financially. So players know that if they get better and they keep rising up, they will be getting more financial rewards. That's something I'd like to see in domestic cricket. So these are the things that I think the BCCI is in a position to do. I'm not a finance person. I haven't looked at the balance sheets. I don't know exactly how much money the BCCI has, but I think it's safe to say that we can increase the proportion of money that is being spent on women's cricket. I think right now, from what we published in our report, there is a very small percentage of the broadcast revenue that the men's team earns, which is directed towards junior and women's cricket. I think that percentage needs to be increased. I think it's something like 0.5%. I'm going to go back to the report and check the figure, but it is a ridiculously small number. And even if we make it 5%, it's not a lot. Just imagine the difference that can make.
Yeah, and we see that with Australia, their grassroots investment is so good that when someone comes to the national team, they're already equipped and prepared as any other player would already be. So I think grassroots investment is key. And I have one more question is, where does the media fit into all of this? How can they play a role in promoting the women's game? Like we've seen Women's Cricket Zone, Female Cricket, your page itself. We've got so many new cricket outlets coming in. How do you think that actually impacts the promotion of the game?
It's huge. And that's why I got into media as opposed to something like coaching at the time I did, because I realized that there wasn't enough being written about women's cricket. There wasn't enough reporting on women's cricket. Forget writing opinion pieces, forget writing player profiles. Just a basic match report, a basic match analysis for every game wasn't appearing on the internet, wasn't appearing in newspapers. And one of my objectives getting into the media at that time was to just increase that footprint of women's cricket in the media. And I'm really proud of the fact that before 2017, before women's cricket suddenly got popular, I was one of the few people doing that. And I'm really happy now that I don't need to think like that anymore. I don't need to do that anymore, because there are platforms, like you said, Women's Cricket Zone, Female Cricket, who are doing the bare essentials, which honestly other cricket websites aren't doing. The major cricket websites like your Crick Infos and your Crick Buzz. So Women's Cricket Zone and Female Cricket, etc. are filling that gap. So the media plays a huge role. Social media plays a huge role. I was trying to do my best to fill in that gap while it was necessary. Now, thankfully, it has become cool to really report on women's cricket and write on women's cricket. So I want to see more and more writers coming up who are passionate about women's cricket, who will write about women's cricket. And if these people who are watching right now, maybe you're a huge women's cricket fan and you want to contribute, start writing articles about it. That's one of the best ways to do it.
Right, absolutely. And I mean, you've got 230,000 subscribers, so there is an audience for it. It's not like no one's listening. It's not like no one's watching. People want this content. And it's important that there are creators for it, because that's how that fan base will sort of grow. So I'm going to just leave you with one last question is, obviously, you have your videos are ranging from tutorials to analysis. So can we expect like a WBBL series coming up that everyone can tune into and see your analysis on it?
Well, my videos haven't really focused on match analysis. My channel, Cricket with Snehal, is more of a tutorial channel. It's more about teaching people cricket, and I keep that universal. So it might be surprising to some to learn that 85% of my audience are young boys, and a very small percentage are actually young girls. But I see it from the point of view of, even though I may not be talking about a particular tournament, men's tournament, women's tournament, I don't do a lot of match-specific stuff. But whenever I'm teaching them, for example, how to play a cover drive or how to bowl a Yorker, this is something actually even I didn't realize, but I was in the 2018 World T20 in West Indies when India had gone there, and Lisa Sarekar came up to me and she's like, your YouTube channel is doing really well, good job. I was like, yeah, okay, fine, okay. No, she made it a point to drill into my head. It's very important that young boys have a female role model teaching them these kind of things. So it changes the perception of what a cricket coach and a cricket expert or just a cricketer looks like in their mind. So boys, even the boys who are growing up, watching my videos and saying that, ma'am, we've been watching you since day one, or I took 5 wickets in the match because I watched your video and those things. They are a new generation who are growing up with a new perception of what is a cricketer, what a cricketer looks like, or what a cricket coach or cricket expert looks like. So may or may not do something around the WBBL, but I will always be making content which will help people learn. And to do it as, I think, the only female in the Indian sports niche on YouTube, that reminds me constantly that it's a responsibility.
Yeah, and absolutely. The young boys will grow up with looking at women as an equal when it comes to cricket. Like, next time a girl goes to the park, they have an equal chance of being picked first as another boy into a cricketing team, right? And I think that's really important, especially for the young girls too. They see that this is possible. There are females who are pursuing cricket and coaching and things like that. And it is a possibility for me. And I think it's very important for you and other people to create that sort of pathway. So, like, thanks a lot for doing that, because it goes a long way in inspiring the future generations.
It just happened. I didn't do it. I didn't intend for that to happen. But I'm glad that it has happened. It just started as a hobby. Now, all of a sudden, I've moved into actually, like, from just teaching in the internet to actually working with kids one-on-one. And there I see the difference in my Cricket with Snehal online academy, where I'm actually working with these kids. I see more girls coming up to learn from me rather than boys, probably a 60-40 split in favor of girls, because then they see, it's like what you keep hearing in women's sport, when what you can't see, you can't be. And when you can see, you can actually aspire to be that.
Yeah, so I'm going to leave you with this, Snehal. It's 4 minutes to the IPL match, so we'll both get on our way to watch it. Thank you so much for this chat, and we hope to have you on soon again for some later topics too.
My pleasure. And if any of your viewers want to check out the report, I've sent you guys a copy. So they can DM either you, or you guys can DM me also. If anyone wants to look deeper into the report, understand it. We are also going to be doing some exciting things once the women's IPL T20 challenge starts up around the report. So hope more and more people can get behind this concept of equality between cricket, just equality for all cricket.
Right, and I'll put your Instagram and YouTube into the caption, so everyone can go and check out Snehal's page too. It's got daily content and it's very exciting. So yeah, I'll leave you with that, Snehal. Thank you so much for coming on.
Thanks for having me, Radha.